You can now use SQL formulas directly in Microsoft Excel. Just like in my example here, I've added an SQL formula to group my orders table by customer ID and then calculate the total amount spent by each customer. This, of course, is just one example. As you know, with SQL, you can do almost anything when it comes to extracting and transforming structured data. In the past, I actually made a similar video, but back then we needed Python installed on our computer to make it work. Now with this new solution, all you need is a 3 Excel add-in called SQLookup. It works right off the box on Windows, Mac and even web version of Excel. So in this video, I will show you how to get started with the add-in and also how to use it. Alright, and without further ado, let us dive in. First things first, we need to install the add-in. To do that, go to the Home tab and navigate to Add-ins. From here, search for SQLookup. Once you found it, click on Add. Alright, and that's already it. We have now installed the add-in. If you look under the Formulas tab, you will now see the SQLookup icon. And when you click on it, it will open the task pane. Now let me insert some sample data into our sheet so that we can see how it works. Alright, so here we have now two tables. One table contains customer data and the other one contains some sample order data. Now since we have installed the add-in, we now have a new formula called SQLookup. This formula now lets you write SQL queries directly in Excel. So for a simple example, let's say I want to get all the customers from New York. To do that, I will write an SQL statement inside the SQLookup formula. In my case, I will select everything from the table and add a filter criteria for the city. For the table name, you can simply use the letter A. After that, you select the range of your table. This can be either an actual Excel table, just like in my case here, or it could be also like a range of cells. So as I said, I will select my table here, and when I press enter, we can see the result down here. Alright, and to make things a bit more readable, I will give this table actually a proper name. Instead of using the letter A, I will call it Customers Table. If you do this, you also need to specify the table name in the formula. So in quotation marks, I will type Customers Table. And the range for this will be my table, which is called Customers. So when I press enter, we can see that it still works. Now to improve the readability even further, you can also write your SQL statements in multiple lines. In Excel, you can do this by pressing Alt and Enter to insert a line break inside the formula. So let me split up the lines like this. And also a quick note here. You don't actually need to capitalize the SQL keywords. I'm just doing it here to make the statement easier to read. So when I press Enter, you will see that it still works. Next up, let's make this formula a bit more dynamic. Instead of hard coding the filter criteria for the city directly into the SQL formula, I want to reference it from a separate cell. For that, I will create a small input field where I can type in the city name. In my case, I will use cell G2 for this. Now in the SQL formula, we will use string concatenation to include the input field as part of the query. Right now the SQL statement is just one long string. To insert the variable, I will break the string by adding quotation marks and use the ampersand to concatenate it with the rest of the formula. With that in place, I can replace the hard-coded New York with the reference cell in G2. So when I press enter, we can see that it still works. Alright, and with that, let's take a look at the other examples I have here in my sheet. For the first example, I'm actually getting a value error. And I can also see an error message in the task pane when I scroll down a bit. And I think this is something to do with my date format. So it might be just an issue on my computer. In your case, perhaps the first example might already work out of the box. But for me, I will need to manually format these dates by setting them to a year, month and day format. Now for the last two entries, I will still see that I have an issue here. To fix this, I will click into each cell and then press enter to apply the new format. Okay, and with that, now it should work. Currently, I'm still seeing a spill error. But this just means there's not enough space for our result. So let me insert a new row here to give the result some room to display. And just like before, let me also quickly format these dates here so that they appear in the year, month and day format. Alright, and with that in place, let us take a look at the SQL formula itself. In this example, we are filtering the orders table by the order date column. The table name orders is defined here and it references to the order table in our sheet. So to test it out, let's filter the data to only show the orders after the 1st of July. When I press enter, we can see the result and we can see that only two orders matches our criteria. Now one important note here. This add-in uses the SQLite dialect under the hood. That is why you have access to the functions DateTime in your SQL statements. And if you want to see all the available SQLite functions, you can check out their documentation. I will of course also leave the link to this documentation in the description box down below. So, for example, under the date and time section, you will find the datetime function we just used. Now, when you are working with dates, you will also need to specify that in the SQLookup formula. So here you will notice that after we specified the table, there's an extra argument where it says date. And if you check the documentation, this is needed to treat the values in the order date column as date or time values. You can either specify the exact column's name that should be treated as dates, or you could just write date, and then all the columns with date in the header names will be treated as dates. That is also why order date is now treated as a datetime value, because it contains date in the column header name. Alright, and with that, let's move on to the next example. Here we are working with two tables and performing an inner join. And just like before, we have given these tables an alias. The order table has an alias of O, and the customer table is alias as C. And now in the SQL statement, we can reference to those tables. Alright, and for the final example, let me hide the other two queries here. In this example, we are using a group by statement to summarize the data. We are grouping it by the customers and calculating the total spending in a new column called total spend. Alright, and that's basically how this add-in works. Now you might be wondering, what happens actually if you delete the add-in or you send this workbook to someone who doesn't have the add-in installed? And to demonstrate you this, I will remove the add-in by right-clicking on it and selecting remove add-in. Once that is done, the results are still visible in my workbook. However, if I try to recalculate the formula, it shows a name error, meaning that the formula can no longer run. Alright, and lastly, let's talk about privacy. The SQL queries actually run locally on your machine. This means no data is sent to an external server. Additionally, the add-in doesn't collect any user statistics, so it is pretty safe to use. Alright, and with that said, let me know what you think of the add-in in the comments below. As always, thanks for watching and I will see you in the next video.